Now, just over a year ago, I made a video about NET, Nottingham's tram system. So today, after learning that Nottingham is the largest municipal bus company in England, i.e. still mainly owned by the local council, I wanted to find out more. So in this video of Thoroughfare, let's look at the history of Nottingham's buses and try to figure out if they're more effective as an operating model. Now, Nottingham has an extensive transport history, from horse-drawn coaches all the way to modern trams, that I could spend hours talking about. So in this video, I'm just going to go off from the point at which diesel motor buses were introduced. But if you are interested in a more extensive history, there's a link popping up now to the NCT timeline page, covering nearly all the major changes. The first diesel buses were introduced in the 1930s, but due to the Second World War, it was only until after large orders of diesel buses could be fulfilled. Soon after the war in the 1950s, trolley buses were in decline and the last petrol buses were also withdrawn, and by 1966, the last trolley bus routes were closed and replaced with diesel buses. The Transport Authority then continued to innovate on the network, introducing their park and rides that operated on Saturdays in 1973, and then introducing the auto fare no change ticketing system the year after. Now, I don't know the exact details of this system, but my assumption is that it rounded fares and made buying tickets on the bus a much faster affair, as it's praised in the timeline as reducing boarding times. Further experimentation continued, and in 1975, the council launched the zone and collar scheme to reduce car traffic during peak times, 7:30 to 9:30 a.m. and 4:30 to 6:30 p.m. during weekdays, with express park and ride services being run to encourage less car usage, though the scheme was quite divisive. The year after, the active fleet peaked with 494 total vehicles, yet the experimental policies that had been introduced in the previous years were slowly reversed after the controlling council was defeated at the ballot box. By 1979, nearly all the services, bar a couple, were one-person operated, and in 1981, the Easy Rider travel card was launched, offering users a prepaid discounted ticket for a period of 14 or 28 days, and in the first year, 12,000 were purchased. During the first half of the 1980s, more routes were introduced to better connect the suburbs to one another, as well as to the city centre, but in 1985 the Transport Act was passed, abolishing the protection that NCT had on its routes, and allowing private companies to compete, whilst also forcing NCT to be set up as a private company, of which the council was the sole shareholder. Then, in the latter half of the 1980s, now trading as Nottingham City Transport Limited, the operator continued to grow with the acquisition of several other operators, and maintained its position as the main civil bus operator in Nottingham, even contributing £50,000 to the feasibility study for the tram system. Now, skipping to the present, NCT operates 67 routes with 100% of their fleet meeting Euro 6 emission standards, and has won UK Bus Operator of the Year 5 times. And in 2019, the last we've had any real data, they received an overall passenger satisfaction of 95%, the highest in the country that year. So that all begs the question, is municipal ownership more effective? Well, let's do a comparison between two relatively similar, in population alone, areas, Nottingham and Wakefield. Now, before I really get into the weeds of this isn't an apples to apples comparison. Each place has individualities and quirks of its own, and the data I'm going to use has wildly different sample sizes between location, and is also from 2019. So, as always, with this sort of comparison, take it with a pinch of salt. So, as already highlighted, in 2019, NCT had an overall satisfaction of 95%, while Arriva in West Yorkshire had just 90%, a clear difference of 5%. So, does that end the argument? Well, no, not really, because Blackpool Transport Buses are also owned by their council, yet they only managed to achieve a 92% overall satisfaction, just a 2% difference. Therefore, let's compare some more specific data from each. From this data, it could be assumed that municipal bus operators are more effective due to both Blackpool and Nottingham having higher overall satisfaction. The clear gap in satisfaction with value for money, though, clearly demonstrates why it's so difficult to compare, as what somebody in Nottingham may consider to be value for money, somebody in Blackpool may not, due to it being a more deprived area than Nottingham. So, whilst it could be said that municipal operation is a more effective model for providing a better service, that conclusion is precarious at best and possibly misleading at worst. All that I would conclude would be that having the council as the majority shareholder, or sometimes the only shareholder, at least means that the profit made by said company is paid out mainly to the council, rather than elsewhere. And that's the interesting element of the British bus industry of municipal ownership, and the odd middle ground between franchising and a fully private system. Tell me what you think about them in the comments below, and as always, have a great day.